even though I have peeked at a ride up twice, I didn't look exactly where to go and what to do. I'm sort of glad I did because it's frustrating that that was there. Anyway, hi friends, welcome back to the channel. I'm a little bit nervous. My name's Ash, I'm a cybersecurity enthusiast, and on this video, we are going over a live walkthrough of Madness, a TryHackMe room. For my notes on this room, timestamps, links, anything else, see the description. Otherwise, let's go. Okay, so we're on TryHackMe. We've got the Madness room here. So we can see by the tags that we've got some steganography, which if you haven't heard of before or need a reminder, it's the practice of concealing information within another message or physical object. But in our case, it's not a physical object. It can be a file or an image. And just as a disclaimer, I have not done this room, so I'm not sure exactly what's involved, what's hidden in what. All right, so I'm gonna go join room. I love the Alice in Wonderland theme. I think that's really cool. We can scroll down. I'm gonna select the start machine and we've got Madness. We're all mad here. So please note that this challenge does not require SSH brute forcing. So we'll try and lock that one away. No brute forcing. Use your skills to access the user and root account. Okay, so this is a boot to root challenge. So we're gonna be accessing somebody and then we're gonna try and escalate our privileges. And we do have a handy hint in case we do get stuck. We'll try and save that just in case I need it. Make sure to have coffee, very important. Iced coffee. It's getting colder here in Australia, but still loving the iced coffees. Lattes, iced lattes. All right, booting up the VM. Let's get on the network, see if we can see our machine. And we can, awesome. So like usual, start with a Rust scan. This looks like a normal boot to root. We have SSH, so we sort of already knew that by the note. There's something on our web server here on HTTP that's gonna help us get access. So let's run this one more time with a bit more details on our two ports. And let's jump over to our web server. All right, so the homepage looks like just our default page. We'll go, not inspect, go view source. So if we just notice a comment here or something purposely left behind. So this sort of sticks out. A comment here saying, they will never find me, and a tryhackme.jpg. So it looks like that's what this icon is up at the beginning here. And since we do know that there's steganography, so it's usually data hidden within images, I think that this is cluing us in to look at this guy. Let's go ahead and copy the link. I'll just have a quick scroll down just in case we're missing anything else. Okay, nothing's sticking out. Before we go any further, I'm just gonna have a quick look at our scan results. Nothing of interest here. So we'll just keep going on with what we found on the front page. I'm just gonna create a directory called Madness, and then we'll just go ahead and grab this JPEG. So it just says data. So there's a few things that we can run against it. We can see that it's 22 kilobytes. So it's not massive. We'll try strings. This is printable characters. And sometimes there's just an easy message or something in here that we can identify. Sometimes there might be something like a programming language or something. There's definitely something here. I mean, I can see like the alphabet, uppercase and lowercase. So they might have something, maybe like a cipher or something hidden in here. You know what's weird is I just realized when I open this in the browser, it says that it's a PNG image in the title. I don't know if that's a clue or just a browser thing. We can also try XF tools. So here again, we see this file type of PNG. So what the browser was picking up on actually was right, but we have the extension as JPEG. So that's showing something's definitely out with this image. So if we look up the magic headers for files, Wikipedia has a good page of the list of file signatures. So if we go ahead and search for our JPEG, we can see here we have a list of different hex values that should be in the file. So we can go ahead and use a tool called Hex Editor, and we can see here in the beginning of the actual file in hex here, this is like what determines the file extension. So currently it's set to a PNG. So if we go back to our list and we look up PNG, we can confirm magic header lines up with what's in the file. So we essentially need to change that so it's reading as a JPEG in order for this to work. So we'll go back to JPEG. So there's a lot of different ones. We can start with this, but pretty confident it's gonna be this one. Let's see if I can paste it in, dude. Not like that. So we'll just do it manually. So FF D8FF E00010 4A4649460001. All right, cool. And we can see here that it's changed. Pick that up and it's worked. So we'll go Control X, we'll go yes. Now we'll go ahead and try and open it and it works this time. And we can see here that the image actually shows this is in Leetspeak. So I did have this scan going for hidden directories and we would have never found it. Sneaky. Okay, so we have a message. Welcome. I've been expecting you. To obtain my identity, you need to guess my secret. Secret entered is, there's gotta be something here. That is wrong. Get out of here. So let's look at the page source. And we have a comment here. It says, it's between 0 and 99, but I don't think anyone will look here. What the heck does that mean? Is there possibly another directory like after this one? Between 0 and 99? Maybe? I do wonder if this is kind of cluing us in for the passphrase, possibly hidden in here. So maybe it's a number between 0 and 99. So what we might be able to do is using Stegseek in the cracking mode. Maybe we can find a word list that actually has like just the numbers. I don't know if that's a thing. So we have all the letters. We have three digits. 000. Can we just have single zeros? Like single digits? Let's go ahead and create a file called numbers. We'll just paste in a list of numbers 0 through 99 and we'll save that off. So I essentially want to use this as my word list and that didn't work. The next thing I'm going to try is a Ferox buster scan with this as my word list and we'll try look within this hidden directory. No luck there. Let's just go back to a normal word list. Maybe there's just something else hidden in there. 0 and 99. Is there any importance of these numbers? But I don't think anyone will look here. After mucking around with it, i.e. peeking at a write-up because I was so stuck, we can do ?secret equals. So it looks like this must be a variable, which is honestly super confusing. I'm not sure how I would have figured this out if I didn't peek. Like nothing here. It's not like there was a JavaScript file or something else insinuating that you can add a variable. This is why I peek at write-ups, because honestly, I would have not thought of doing that. I was doing directories. I know what to do here. So I'm just going to grab a URL. We can fuzz this a couple of ways. I'm going to open up Burp Suite. I will go target, we'll open browser. I'm going to paste this in and select enter to get us back to this page. This is going to show us this request that we just made and I'm going to right click and send it to the intruder. Okay, and it's already automatically picked up where we want our payload. So we'll go over to our payload. We'll go from a simple list to numbers. We'll go from 0 to 99, stepping at one digit at a time with no fractions. So we just have whole numbers. I don't know if URL encoding changes anything. I'll just uncheck it. We'll go start attack. I think that there's a better way of receiving the information, like so I don't have to siphon through them still one by one. I don't know how to do that. But I usually look for something that's different. And since our status works each time, it's a little bit tricky. I think we still just have to scroll through them. So I'm just going to select the first one, go response, and then look at the rule. And then we can just manually go through them until I see something different. All the way down the end. Almost. We see that there is something different. You got it right, but I won't tell you who I am. And we see some gibberish. So this could be the passphrase, or this could be what's, this could be something else. So I'm gonna go straight to Cyber Chef, see if this is picked up by anything, and we can just play around, see if it's like rotated at all. It's weird, because if it was rotated, I don't know if it would include numbers, lowercase, uppercase, and exclamation mark. Like that's a little unusual for a rotation. Same for like a base. Hail Mary that this is actually like root extracted data to hidden. Okay, there was something, my hunch was right. Okay, we have a hidden.txt. Fine, you found the password. Here's a username. I didn't say I would make it easy for you. All right, I think that this is what's rotated. I looked at the hint. Something is rotated. All right, there it is. We've got our username. So does this mean that the password is what we found? No. Right, so we've found this username, but we still don't know like a password. This is a frustrating one. I peeked again. Don't judge me. I had a suspicion of this, but apparently there is another image with the password. I haven't gone through anything yet. My suspicion is this image has got something. I could be wrong. Let's W get it. Let's go through the usuals. Nothing standing out at me from a quick string. Spinwalk should show something if it's truly a JPEG. Okay, it does say that it is a JPEG. Maybe I'm not looking in the right place. I knew it. No passphrase, but there's a password.txt hidden inside of it. Damn, that is good. All right, there's the password. So now we can SSH in, paste in the password from the other image, and we're finally in. Even though I have peeked at a write-up twice, I didn't look exactly where to go and what to do. I'm sort of glad I did because it's frustrating that that was there. Anyway, we're in now. So let's get our user.txt. Go ahead and paste that into TryHackMe. Awesome. So now it's over to privilege escalation. So usually runs sudo dash L. Since we have the password, we can throw that in. Make sure you put it in properly and not the flag. Third time's the charm. What the hell am I doing? Finally got it. But it says, sorry, user joker may not run sudo on the Ubuntu. So we don't have any way of running sudo. All right, let's see if there's any other users. When in doubt, linp's about. I'm gonna go over to my scripts, start a Python web server, and go ahead and download linp's.sh from said server. Great, cancel that. All right, there we've got our linp's. Let's go add executability to it, and let's execute. Linp's is finished. If we see a red yellow, that's great. Red is worth taking a look at, so just point of going down the list. Possibly out of date Linux version. So the first thing is exploit DB. That can be a good sign. We have a local priv escalation. I will leave it open. We'll keep it on the maybes. What I try and do, because I can spend so much time going through all these, I try and find the ones I think this means that it's been verified. So just try and follow one of these. Seeing another local priv escalation. Also seeing one with Metasploit. That could be a quick win. All right, so we might just leave that there and we'll keep going down the list. So we have a pseudo version of 1.8.16. We can't run anything with sudo anyway, so that's not gonna work for us. All right, look, just throw it in, try it. Unknown user. All right, let's give this a go. This with Metasploit. MSF console. I haven't updated this. I think it should be fun. We've got name Linux BPF local privilege escalation. Can I just search for that? BPF signature extension or BPF privilege escalation. I think it's number one in my case. I think so. Options. Compile, listening host, listening port. Am I supposed to get this the machine? Whoa, how do I do that? No, it doesn't because it requires Metasploit. Yeah, now I'm getting a bit confused. Maybe I will come back to this. Compile C file. GCC-V. So I've gone ahead and grabbed that original C program I was looking at. The thinking is to just compile this, copy it over, and then run it from the target machine. And hopefully that'll escalate privileges. GCC-V. And here we have A out. Set up the Python server. Go ahead and run our wget. Our attack box for A.out. Go ahead and grab that. We will change mod and add execution on it. We will go ahead and run that. And straight away we have this version is not found because I guess I need this library to run it. That's not going to work. What next? I think I might be looking at something. Such a broad statement. By looking at the cron tab, I think this might be it. Root is changing directories into the root directory and then using run parts. Port. And then it's testing this thing. Can we like exploit this or something? Linux prep privilege escalation by exploiting cron jobs. And cron is defined as a cron with the ability to perform the task that is skipped due to some reason. This type of cron job are placed in the following directory. You know what I forgot to do is even look for anything with permissions that I could actually use. So there might be something in one of these. Surely it's not that easy though. I already knew that it wouldn't be that easy. Fping, hping 3. No. Sudo mount, we do that. It's not gonna work if I'm not on the sudo. So how does this actually, how is that supposed to actually work though? Umount, screen. It can be used to break out from restrictive environments by spawning an interactive shell. Sudo screen. Okay, we've got a note here. This works on screen version 4.0.5. Data is appended to the file and a new line is converted to. Okay, I think I used this. Don't understand. Okay, so if I run screen, maybe a file and I can echo a data, like maybe I can just put a reverse shell into it. So apparently I can append using this. So can I just do a test? It's like the cron tab and just echo. Did I remove the file? It looks like it is empty now. Back up here, it definitely had data in it. So it works. I mean, it's not actually putting anything in the cron tab. It's just removed all the data. This was supposed to append, overwrite. How about we just look out a little bit further and we can just look up some exploit. So we've looked at different local privilege escalation, but here is something a little bit more specific to what we uncovered. Let's see if we can use it. Usually I just put things in the home directory, but I've seen more to like use the temporary directory for this sort of thing. I don't know if it really makes a big difference. Let's make an exploit.sh and paste this in. It's bash script, so I've already called it, given the right file extension. So we should be able to change mod and add the executable to it. And we can go ahead and give it a shot. Hell yeah, let's go. So yeah, that actually worked. That was a lot of trial and error. I think I just need to do a little bit more researching in future. So let's cd to the root directory and we'll cat out that root.txt and we go ahead and get our flag. We can put that in and we got through madness. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this little bit more raw, a little bit more live walkthrough. Anyway, so thanks so much for liking, commenting, subscribing, all that YouTube stuff. I appreciate you guys. Up on the screen, you're going to see the video to gaming server, another try hack me walkthrough. Definitely check that one out. Otherwise, thanks guys. I'll see you in the next video.